Good morning, Center Church. Thanks for being with us this morning for our virtual service. I have quite a few announcements to share with you this morning. First of all, remember to keep Pastor Cecil in your prayers as he continues to recover from COVID and from having outpatient surgery this past Thursday. He is doing well, but we just want to keep him in our prayers so that he gets to his full recovery. Pastor Cecil also wants to hear from everybody about your fasting and your prayer time that you did in January. Give him a call or email to share your experience of how God worked through your life during that fasting and prayer time. Also, please keep everyone on our prayer list this week in your thoughts. There are a lot of people from our church that are suffering from COVID, recovering from COVID, family members that have been lost. Please look through that list and keep everybody in your prayers this week. We have a request from our church historian, Linda Hall. She is asking for pictures so that she can keep our history updated with photos of events and gatherings from Center Church. You can email those to her or text them to her, or she really likes the real pictures too. Her email address is sthlch@hotmail.com. Or you can text her or call her at 336-317-2116. Also, be sure to check out the email addition to our weekly update that you got this week from, it has the Project Agape February newsletter entitled Fate Will Find a Way. Dottie McCall and Carol Forrest have continued collecting items for the homeless, and they thank everyone for their support and donations that they've given so far. They really are in need of hand and foot warmers, like the kind that you get in the camping department at Walmart or Target. They need chapsticks. They need small bottles of hand lotion. But they're also accepting monetary donations if you prefer to do it that way, and then they can purchase the items that they need to deliver to the homeless. They have sent out over 100 bags of food items to the homeless through this ministry, and they really appreciate everyone's support. For Summerfield Youth, we have quite a few announcements. One, there is going to be a Youth Super Bowl themed session at Center's Field on February 7th, and they need a second adult there to help chaperone. So please get in touch with Katie if you are willing to do this and available. Also, the Youth Council is going to meet soon via Zoom. It'll be on a Tuesday evening at 6:30. If that time frame does not work for you, then let Katie know so that she can get something scheduled differently. On February 14th, Youth will do a Valentine's-themed caroling to all of the homebound as one of their outreach projects. On February 17th, the youth is going to meet online to do a session about Ash Wednesday and hear a message from their pastors. So lots of activities going on for Summerfield Youth. You can also check out summerfieldyouth.com, and they're also on Instagram with all of the updates and upcoming activities, and get in touch with Katie too. Katie also thanks everybody for their continued prayers and support as she and her husband have recovered from COVID this January. The backpack ministries, we need donations for February. The Knorr packages of noodles, canned green beans, plastic jars of peanut butter and jelly, pasta sauce, or cans of pasta sauce, beef stew, or chili. All of those things that they can send home with kids in their backpacks that are not breakable. Please donate those items and just leave them on the bench by the church entrance, and they will be picked up and delivered. Also, don't forget to send in your videos for Tell Me Something Good. We all like seeing those every week. Caroline Raper puts those together, so please send her your videos or your thoughts, anything, something good that you want to share with our community, because it's a great way for us to keep up with what everybody's doing right now when we can't see each other in person. Her email address is carolineraper@gmail.com. Or you can text her at 336-423-8091. I think that's all of the announcements, and I hope everybody has a great Sunday. Miss seeing you guys. Take care.
No ocean, no valley,
no mountain too high, no power on earth, there's no distance too wide, no height or no depth could keep me from your love. No failure, no weakness, no doubt in my mind, no prison around me could keep you outside, no, not even death can pull me from your heart. Nothing ever could separate us. And when I can't see you, still I know you're here. And when I can't feel you, your promise is clear. Nothing I face can keep me from your love. My Savior, my healer, my life and my hope, my treasure forever, with you I belong. And even in death, we won't be torn apart. Nothing ever could separate us. Nothing ever could separate us. Nothing ever could separate us.
Good morning, guys. I hope you've had a great week. Today's a special day. I hope it's going to be fun.
Oh, yeah, it's a special day.
Oh goodness. Yeah. Hey, McCaffrey, I'm trying to work on my children's time. You want to come help?
Sure. Hey, everybody. You know what today is? Today is one of my favorite days. Super Bowl Sunday. You know what's great about Super Bowl Sunday? We got football. You got the halftime show. You got cool commercials. And guess what else? Wonderful food and lots of it. You know what else, though? Since we're talking about that, you know, food's been a big part of the Bible. Even from the fish and loaves miracle that Jesus performed to something that we're going to do today, which is when Jesus gathered with his disciples and he had communion with his disciples at the Last Supper. So we're gonna have communion today, and we can all do it together at the end of this service. So here's a video for you. Don't forget the Super Bowl. Have a good day.
Hey kids, does your family have any traditions? Like maybe on Christmas you open your presents the night before, or maybe on Easter you dye eggs with your family.
Well, in today's lesson, we're going to be learning about a tradition Christians have, and it's called communion. Communion is when Christians eat bread and drink grape juice at church.
Have you ever been at church when they pass around juice and crackers? Or maybe they have everyone walk up to the front of the room and grab a cracker and dip it in juice?
Now that might sound a little weird that everyone would take a snack break in the middle of church.
But it's actually something really important that Christians have done for a really long time.
And best of all, it was Jesus' idea. Jesus invented communion all the way back in the New Testament.
Just before Jesus went to the cross, he had a big meal with all of his disciples to celebrate something called Passover.
At that dinner, he told them all that he is going to go to the cross and die.
He wanted to give them a way to remember him and what he was about to do.
So he took some bread, and he took some wine, and he told them what they meant.
In communion, bread stands for Jesus' body, and the drink stands for his blood. Body and blood? That sounds kind of gross.
But the whole point is to remember what Jesus did on the cross.
See, the bread stands for all the ways his body was beaten and broken on his way to the cross.
And the wine stands for all the blood he spilled on the cross, which saves us from our sin and allows us to go to heaven. Memory verse.
This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And that's why communion is so special. Communion helps us remember that Jesus is the center of it all.
Jesus gave us communion so that we will never forget what he did for us.
He loved us so much, he was willing to die for us.
So kids, the next time you're taking part in one of your family traditions, remember this lesson.
And remember, communion is an awesome way to show what Jesus did for us.
Tell me something good.
People tell me how much they like the Tell Me Something Good segment, but I need participation to keep it going. If you're not comfortable sending me a video, you can send me your good news and I'll create something for you. But if you want to see Tell Me Something Good, then...
Tell me something good!
Just a picture of me getting ready to go into surgery on Thursday. Had a hernia surgery, everything went well. And now I'm recuperating at home. Be a few more days, but then I should be back in the office. Thank you for your prayers and your thoughts, and for all the ones that have brought food. That's been great. Thank you so much.
Lord, let us pause and pray. Lord, you've said that to truly love you, then we must also love our neighbor, which can be difficult when we disagree or lifestyles clash. Yet in overcoming those difficulties, it is possible to see the miracle that you love someone like me. Teach us to love, Lord, as you have loved us, that this world might be a better neighborhood in which to live and share. We pray that we will remember that you are the God who brings life from tiny seeds buried in the soil. You design the butterfly who waits in a chrysalis while your miracle of transformation takes place. Help us to trust you as you make us into a display of your splendor. Thank you for your promise to see your good works in us through to completion. He who has begun a work, a good work in you, will complete it. Philippians 1:6. Thank you for your promise to make us new. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation is come, the old is gone, and the new is here. 2 Corinthians 5:17. We pray that your Holy Spirit will help us to experience your peace, which surpasses all understanding. Help us to live in your light and shine brightly for you. Help us to rejoice and be glad throughout this day that you have made. Thank you that you may leave us, you may never leave us, and you will never forsake us. Hebrews 13:5. We pray for Catherine Bennett, Virginia, Amy Salem, Marvin McCraney, June and Danny, Bernie, Benny and her grandson, the family of Buddy Allen, the Boozer family, the Southard family. We pray for Gail Price and her husband, Bob. We pray for Sydney Chandler, Larry and Martha Clayton, Lorraine Grubb, our pastor, Cecil Donahue, Meredith Riggs and her husband, April Poling, 7-year-old. We pray for all the church members, their families and friends. dealing with COVID. We pray for the family of Linda Henderson. We thank you for all that have recovered from COVID. Their numbers are great. We thank you for being together today. We pray for our country, the leaders, our law enforcement, emergency workers, firefighters. We pray for our neighbors, our church, as well as the unknown needs of others. We pray for the needy, the sick, and oppressed. Lord, heal our land. Lord, protect those in the front lines, those serving the sick, and those in essential ministries. Let all Christians and churches reach out with hope and love while people's hearts are open. Lord, how can we bless our church family financially during these challenging days? Lord, please use us to bless others in Jesus' name. And now, as Christ has taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The scripture reading for today comes from Mark chapter 12, verses 28 through 34. One of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked him, "Of all the commandments, which is the most important?" "The most important one," answered Jesus, "is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these." "Well said, teacher," the man replied. "You are right in saying that God is one, and there is no one other but him. To love him with all your heart, with all your understanding, and with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself, is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." And from then on, no one dared ask him any more questions.
In the cross of Christ I glory, tearing o'er the wrecks of time. All thy light and sacred story gathers round its head sublime. When the woes of life overtake me, hopes deceive and fears annoy, never shall the cross forsake me, though it goes with peace and joy. When the sun of bliss is beaming, light and love upon my way, from the cross the radiant streaming adds more luster to the day. Made and blessing bless this treasure by the cross of sanctified. Peace is there that knows no measure, joys that through all time abide. In the cross of Christ I glory, towering o'er the wrecks of time. All the light of sacred story gathers round its head sublime.
Grace and peace from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'm Bev Copley, the Northern Piedmont District Superintendent, here with a word for you from Proverbs chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. This is mostly from the New Revised Standard Version, just a little bit of an older version thrown in as well. My child, do not forget my teaching, but let your heart keep my commandments. For length of days and years of life and abundant welfare they will give you. Do not let loyalty and faithfulness forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart, so you will find favor and good repute in the sight of God and of people. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. It will be a healing for your flesh and a refreshment for your body. When I was a kid in elementary school, I had the blessing of riding a school bus. I loved the bus. On the bus, I conversed, made friends, and discovered my hometown of Lexington, North Carolina. Once I talked on the bus so much that I got a paddling. But that's a story for another day. Once the bus broke down and I began to cry. Again, a story for another day. Once I even cut my chin on the bus steps and had to get 7 stitches. A story for another day. Suffice it to say, I spent a lot of my childhood on a school bus. Because I live farther from school, I was the first on in the morning and the last off in the afternoon. I embarked in my journey on very early in the mornings from a school bus stop called the Triangle. We loved the Triangle. It was a grassy area, perfect for kickball and races on our bicycles around the perimeter. From the Triangle, we journeyed all over Lexington and ended up at Eanes School and eventually at Cecil School as well. In the afternoons, we reversed our journey, gradually making our way back to the Triangle and ultimately home. My greatest bus blessing was Carolyn. She was in my class most years. I saved her a seat on the bus every morning. Carolyn often came to my house to visit, but she was never allowed to spend the night. And for some reason, a reason that remained unclear to me for most of my childhood, I was only allowed to see Carolyn's house from the school bus. I remember being confused about this. She went to Carowinds with us. We had a great time at Carowinds. We rode all the rides we could together. We have pictures in our family album of that happy day. But still, no sleepovers and no visits to her home. I was confused. I remained confused. Carolyn's skin color was not the same skin color as mine, not that different, but maybe for our families different enough. Our families noticed it, I guess, before we did. And even once we noticed it, we didn't care. But I suspect that others did. We went on to play on the same sports teams, middle school and high school. We graduated the same year, but we were never as close as we were in those years of elementary school. There were so many limits with Carolyn that I didn't have with some of my other friends. And this remained a mystery of my childhood until I was older and I learned about desegregation busing. I spent lots of time on the bus because I did not attend the elementary school that was nearest to my house. I never even knew that there was a school closer to my home. It was not a problem for me at all, but it was a much debated topic at the time. Busing doesn't exist anymore. My children have never even heard of it. It was apparently to grown-ups a significant topic of hot conversation in the early 1970s. Eventually, I learned that Carolyn's father was the first black police officer in our whole town. As the years unfolded, Carolyn's father eventually became our first black police chief and a member of the city council. He was one of Lexington's most prominent citizens. He died in 2009. I grew up confused about race, not understanding the disputes behind busing, not even understanding busing at all. Just knowing that riding a bus widened my world and gave me great friends. I appreciate recent articles teaching us how to talk to children about race. As for my parents, I don't know if they would have read them or not. I like to think my mom would have. She's passed away, so I can't say for sure. Racism is often shared from one generation to the next, passed down. A sin visited by parents upon their children and often to their children's children. I share this memory not to brag about my friendships, but to wonder along with you, what happened that kept Carolyn and me from being friends throughout school and throughout life? Why did it come to be that by middle school we were only teammates instead of best friends? And that by high school we may or may not have even signed each other's yearbooks? We were so much alike. And yet we were taught that we were so different. My parents socialized me to focus on our differences instead of our similarities. Why didn't I ask more questions? Why didn't I reach out to Carolyn? What could I have done better? What could my parents have done better? Have I done better by my children? What happened to Carolyn and me? The answer to that question may be a part of the solution to one of the current crises in our country right now. In this time of national division and partisan politics, everyone wants to know, how do you lean? Do you lean left or right, red or blue? Liberal, conservative, this way or that way? The Old Testament book of Proverbs offers a corrective for us. It encourages us not to lean left or to lean right or lean liberal or lean conservative. Biblical wisdom prohibits binary thinking. The biblical corrective is to lean not at all upon your own understanding. In a time when we are so in search of wisdom, let us avail ourselves of some of the most practical instructions in the Bible. Maybe Proverbs can help. After all, they don't call it wisdom literature for nothing. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him and He will make your path straight. Proverbs 3 begins with the phrase, my child. What follows is going to be in the context of a relationship. What follows and flows from it will be life-giving for length of days, years of life, abundant welfare. In other words, pay attention. Our world's sorely in need of life-giving words right now. And the admonition is to listen with the heart. Let your heart keep my commandments. It is the heart that keeps commandments, not the mind. The heart remembers what's right. The mind forgets in the heat of the moment. Scripture teaches us that loyalty and faithfulness do matter in our relationship with God, but also in our relationship with people. Loyalty and faithfulness are so important to right living that we're instructed to bind them around our necks and write them on the tablets of our hearts. Whatever's written there on your heart will be remembered. It's a very sacred sentiment. It's a physical reminder of the call to faithfulness. Is there a symbol that you might need to wear, a cross perhaps, or even a heart? The place around your neck, literally, that would help you to remember loyalty and faithfulness. Proverbs 3 has a stated goal for human life: favor and good repute in the sight of God and of people. I've been doing funerals for over 30 years, and I will tell you that not everyone achieves that stated goal. I'll leave that there. We're called to trust the Lord with all our heart, not part of it. And trust Him with the mind, that is never mentioned here. The godly life does have cerebral involvement. God does not want us to check our brains at the door. God wants us to think. But the godly life is not a cerebral or even a logical endeavor. We're told not to rely on our own understanding. It's implied that our own understanding is severely limited, myopic. Lean not on your own understanding. How many of us have been guilty, even lately, of leaning only on our own understanding? How often have we displayed a lack of knowledge, a bias, an arrogance, or our own assumptions? In all your ways, acknowledge God. Make God your major partner in life's work and in life's words. What would that look like for you? How would it change your language, your posture, your actions? I looked at several versions of this scripture, and it said phrases like, let God lead, and words like submit are used to literally be a person living under God in every way. Even our language reflects the presence or the absence of God. The joyful product of submission is what the Bible calls a straight path. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. What does a straight path look like in your life? How might that be different from a path chosen by someone else? Or chosen by the choice to become wise in your own eyes? To me, justice is a straight path. We go astray when we are guided by our own eyes. As the passage draws to a close, it mentions fearing the Lord. The book of Proverbs actually claims that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. This theme occurs throughout the 31 chapters of Proverbs. Fearing the Lord. To me, that's not terror. It's awe and it's respect. And I find in my ministry that when God-fearing people get together, they have a mutual regard for the great act of community discernment. And the group wants to be found faithful. The group collectively pushes away from evil at that point. The group collectively does good. The scripture concludes with a wonderful promise, the promise of healing and the promise of refreshment. Gosh, that's good news for our world right now. Our spiritual posture has implications for the life of our flesh. Our very bodies need refreshment during this parched time. Our corporate flesh needs healing, and our national body needs refreshment. Let justice roll down like the waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. The healing, the refreshment, the rolling down, the ever-flowing begins with the individual and that individual's relationship with God. There's a line in the Lord's Prayer that asks simply for the kingdom to come on earth. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. We ask that God might help make heaven's ways our ways. We acknowledge that God's will is always directed to our good, but we also confess our own ability to bring the kingdom to bear all by ourselves without God's help. It doesn't work like that. It seems tempting to just let what is lost remain lost. That's called despair. And that's never been God's way. And that wasn't the way that we learned from Jesus. It wasn't His style. Jesus came to bring God's good plan for humanity, to bring us back to that place of holding and being held. We must never give up on the kingdom and on kingdom principles. We continue to pray, Thy kingdom come. And we continue to bring it into existence by leaning not on our own limited understanding of the human journey. What we do matters. And peace in the kingdom is made one relationship at a time. We have a role in the transformation of society. And most of what Jesus did in his ministry was person-to-person transformation. He took a role in the coming kingdom. He brought it and he bought it. And he taught it. For Jesus, it wasn't ever about which way he leaned. To ascribe politics to Jesus is just to continue to crucify him, even all the way up until the 21st century, and to miss the point of his ministry. Jesus' focus was always to guide us upwards, not to teach us to lean one way or the other here on earth. At the cross, the crucified Christ looked up. At the resurrection, the risen Christ was released of all obstacles, and so are we. And at his ascension, the disciples continued looking up. Let's continue to look up too. Let's continue to witness to God's ability to remove obstacles that would keep us from relationships. As we close, I want to imagine yourself having that same intimacy with the Father that Jesus himself enjoyed. Jesus knew full well that his conversations were overheard in heaven. And I want you to know full well your conversations are overheard in heaven. Jesus was the very embodiment, the true incarnation of God's heart in the world. He lived and taught the good life and made practical choices. He was a dear child, a beloved son, and he talked to us as children. And out of that same love that sprang from the Proverbs of old, my child, do not forget my teaching. I recently reunited myself with Carolyn, the best way that I know how during a pandemic. It's called Facebook. I told her I think of her often, and I remember fondly our days of friendship, Carowinds, and playing sports together, that I remembered the bus. And I thanked her for being my friend. And I shared my gratitude for her life and her impact on me. She wrote me back. She called me by my real name, Beverly. If you knew me back then, I was Beverly. She said she remembered our time as well. She called us the best of besties. She expressed appreciation for our friendship and our time together. And she said, my heart knows no distance or time when it comes to you. My heart feels the very same. The heart does know, doesn't it? Let us pray. God in heaven, you are God among us. You're a loving parent and you offer us the resources for a holy life here on earth. You know our hearts, and from your teaching, you've taught us that good follows good and collapse follows evil. So you call us to seek wisdom as one searches for silver and hidden treasure. May we as Christians seek wisdom from you, wisdom that would guide our relationships and our witness. Give us the loving hearts of children and the prophetic courage of influential parents. Make us leaders with you, for you, and because of you. We can't wait. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Let's all say our prayer of confession together. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against you and your love. We have not loved our neighbor, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord be with you. You don't have to say that. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth, God of Abraham and Sarah, God of Miriam and Moses, God of Joshua and Deborah, God of Ruth and David, the God of the priests and the prophets, the God of Mary and Joseph, the God of the apostles and the martyrs, the God of mothers and fathers, the God of our children in all generations. And so with the people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise you and join in the unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, he gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And then on the night which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave you thanks, broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. He blessed it, and he gave it to the disciples, said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you would in remembrance of me." And so in the remembrance of these mighty acts of God in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ, the offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them to be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with all your saints, especially for those whom we've named today. Since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, strengthen us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. By your Holy Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty, now and forever. Amen. So if you'll take your packets or your bread that you brought, open that and take the wafer. This is the body of Christ, broken for you. Eat it in remembrance of him. Then drink the juice. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of your sins. Drink this in remembrance of what he did on the cross for you. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks for the sound of fellowship and how we really can know and do know the love Christ had for his disciples and the fellowship they had. How he's willing to be a servant, even though he was the master. May we serve each other in our families and in this church and in the world, that through our actions and our words, they may see your Son, Jesus, For we pray in his name. Amen.
Take